Good day to you this Wednesday. My name is Brian Mead. I'm here with the Meek Street Church of Christ, and we're studying God's Word today. And hope you take your Bible and follow along with the lesson of the hour as I share the screen that we're going to talk about today. We have a good lesson about how do you read the Bible, and I hope you'll follow along and pay attention closely to the things that we're going to say today, that we do have something worth saying today as we look at pages of God's Word this very day. I want you to take your Bibles, first of all, to our lesson text found in Luke chapter 10, 25 to verse 29. And we're going to read about an instance when Jesus was talking to a lawyer. And in verse 25, the Bible tells us, "And the lawyer stood up and put him to the test, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' And he said to him, 'What is written in the law? How does it read to you?'" And that's really what the basis of our lesson is about in that particular verse, verse 26 in particular. Verse 27, it goes, "And he answered, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' And he said to him, 'You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live.' But wishing to justify himself, he said to Jesus, 'Who is my neighbor?'" And so that's what we want to talk about today. How do you read the Bible? And that's not a question about the ability to read. We learned that back in school about how to read with put all the letters together and the sentences and everything like that. We learn about grammar in school, in high school. We learn about English and things like that. Now talk about the eloquence as well. Someone might be more eloquent in speaking than someone else, being able to say things a lot more eloquently than I do. And that may be the very case easily. But we're talking about really, how do we read the text? How do we draw out what is supposed to be in the text? There's a word, it's a big word, it refers to eisegesis and exegesis. Those are two words I actually want to use in this lesson as we talk about this. Exegesis is where we draw out what is actually in the text and what is actually the meaning of the text as it is written in God's Word. And that's exactly what this lawyer did. He took that and he exegeted the text, if you will, and he looked at it as something that this is what the meaning of how to find eternal life. And Jesus praised him for that. He commended him highly for his exegesis. But then there's a word called eisegesis as we'll look at this. It's what we put into the text. And it's not really in there. It's not warranted. It's something that's added because of the personal preferences and the biases of the person reading the text. They may add words or meanings that are not there in the text, plainly not there in the text. And so there's a lot of times that people will do this, maybe not realize what they've done by thinking that something is in the passage that they're looking at, when it's really not there at all. They've added this meaning, or they think that the passage is saying something that it doesn't mean. So that's the basis of our lesson today. I want to talk about three things. First of all, how do you read about the church that Jesus established? The Bible teaches us in Matthew chapter 16, verses 17 to 19. Here the Bible says, here Jesus, and he said to him, to Simon Peter, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah," he calls him Simon Bar-Jonah there, "because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. I also will say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it. I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven." And that's reading from the New American Standard Bible. And there's some things I want to talk about, same words I want to key in on this. As some will read this passage, these three verses, 17, 18, and 19, they will say, well, here it's Peter's church. Jesus actually giving him the keys or the ownership of the church there. And how Peter is the first pope there. He's the one who is the head disciple, and later on becomes the pope in some people's minds. But that's not what's taking place here. That is eisegesis. And the really proper exegesis is that Jesus is talking to Peter about what will take place in the gospel age. And he's talking about here, though, the word Peter. As we look at this word Peter in the Greek, it refers to someone who is a stone. And we'll actually look at the other word rock there as well. Now, the first one is the Petros, which is a stone. And it's not a large stone. It's like a pebble in some respects. It's a small stone. Then there is the Greek Petra, which the purple refers to there, is a large rock, a bedrock. Now, what's going on here? Is he saying, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock. So I'm going back to the idea Jesus changed his name from Simon Bar-Jonah to Peter. And he's talking about, well, is it talking about him making himself, Peter, the bedrock of our salvation and the one who is the head of the church in some respects? No, he's actually saying in this passage that the confession that Peter just made in verse 16, how that he made that great confession that we come to know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And that is the confession upon which the church was established. Not upon the basis of Peter, but himself, not because he gave him some kind of binding power of loosing and things like that. He actually is talking to all the disciples. You look at Matthew chapter 18. He actually refers to all the disciples there in that regard. And so this idea of giving to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven. Now that's actually the tense in the Greek. It refers to a binding and loosing that takes place. It's already taken place in heaven, and really Peter's receiving that from heaven, how to do and how to act in the kingdom age. You know, God is the one who's the head. Actually, Jesus himself is the head of the church. And he is the one who gives us our proper marching orders, if you will. And so Peter does not have any binding and loosing power on his own. Now, some read that into the text to make it think that Peter was just making up rules and laws, and that heaven had to go behind and accept those laws and actually follow those laws and teachings. No, actually, it's the other way around. It's the tail not wagging the dog, but it's the dog wagging the tail, if you say, so to speak. And so Peter is the one who was listening to Jesus and listening to Christ, and it's not his church, but it's actually Christ's church, as we come to know that he is the head of the church. As Matthew 16, verse 18 says, I will build my church. But then there's some who read in it, I will build Martin Luther's church. And that's one of those things we see of denominationalism all around us today, that people have different types of churches, different faiths that are out there in the world today. But is it right, though? That is the question. Is this, and I want to challenge your beliefs on this. I'm not trying to attack anyone's faith, but simply trying to do what the Bible says and encourage other people to do what the Bible says as well. And if you find something that you're doing, if you're going to a church that you can't read about in the scriptures, I encourage you to find one that is Bible-based, that's actually following the Word of God without addition or subtraction. And that's, in some essence, we are helping people to know the truth of God's will in that way. And some might say, well, after all, one name is as good as another. Now, Shakespeare said, a rose called by any other name would smell just as sweet. But that is poetry. When it comes to names, we know names are important to God, and we know that we cannot have just any name over the door of the church, because what if we decide to put Satan's name there? You know, one name is as good as another. That argument falls apart when you put different churches. The Church of the Jezebels, that would also be something that is not proper, because that we understand that name has a lot of connotation with that, with Ahab and Jezebel in the Old Testament. But there is a slogan that many people say, join the church of your choice. And I will say, what choice do we have when Jesus already has a church? We don't have a right to come behind him, to make a church and design our own way of worship and do things peculiar to us. Now, we have to realize Jesus already has a church established. We need to be part of that church and be a part, going back to the root of Christianity when Jesus said, I will build my church. Again, that attitude of it doesn't matter what name is over the door. You can call yourself Baptist or Pentecostals or Methodist and Trinity Lutherans there, like the sign says there. But what does it matter? Does it matter to God? The Bible says, Colossians chapter 3, verse 17, whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God through him or by him. In 1 Peter 4, verse 11, the Bible says, if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. And so we have to say what the word of God says. And I've looked, and this is one of the things that I point out to people sometimes, that the name Baptist Church, that the name Catholic Church or Pentecostal Church, it, as a church, is not in there in the scriptures. Now, I know the church was established on Pentecost, but it was not ever called a Pentecostal church. It was simply the church of our Lord Jesus Christ, because he would build my church. That actually denotes the ownership. When Jesus says my church, it belongs to him, and we don't have a right to change anything about the church of the New Testament. And Christ is the head and founder of this particular church. The one you read about in the scriptures, to have proper exegesis, we have to simply let him be the founder and the head of the church. Sometimes you hear about this is the founding and leading pastor of a particular denomination. Well, if you think that, then you're taking that away from Christ, because he is the founder. He is the one who's the head of the church. And oftentimes, pastors so-called, which are really not really biblical pastors, because they're actually elders and presbyters in the Lord's church. But you know, we understand Jesus is the one who said he would build the church, and he did build the church. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22 teaches us to put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church. And that excludes me. I can't come behind and make up my own church, the church of the holy hallelujahs. I can't do that if I want to follow Christ the way that is instructed in the word. Ephesians chapter 5, 23 talks about it. Husbands is the head of the wife, or husbands are the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church and the savior of the body in the singular sense. And so we realize that's exactly his place. It all goes back to Matthew 16, verse 18. That promise that he would build the church, and it came true in Acts chapter 2 as the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. And the church belongs to Christ. That is obvious. Acts 20, verse 28, he told the Ephesian elders there at Miletus to feed the church of God, or shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. Now, who purchased the church with his own blood? It was Christ, wasn't it? Christ went to the cross for you and I. He died. He paid the price. That's why God glorified him, gave him a name above all other names. And that's why all we are in subjection to him, as he is ruling and reigning over his kingdom today. Colossians 1, verse 13, he translated us into the kingdom of his, out of the power of darkness, into the kingdom of his dear son, or the son of his love. And that says about something about the church, the kingdom. I believe that church, we mentioned the keys to the kingdom and the church are one and the same, as we realize the church has the authority of heaven, and that we're to be a part of that kingdom that was promised and was established on Pentecost of AD 33. Romans 16, 16 tells us the churches of Christ salute you. With a great one another with a holy kiss, the churches of Christ greet you. That's something that we unrealize is biblical. We find what the word of God says. Let's stick to that and not take anything, try to read something in the passage that is not there. Well, how do you read the scriptures? Well, some read the church, our church is a denomination. I've had that many times as I've talked to, had that question posed, what denomination are you a part of? I basically say I'm not part of any denomination. There's a lot of people who feel the same way, that the church is non-denominational, that you cannot find a denomination in the Bible without it being something it's disapproved of. You know, the Bible does not want us to divide up into different groups. And I will say that because that's what the Bible teaches. In John chapter 10, verse 16, though, some read the scriptures as if it were a denomination being talked about here. It says, and other sheep I have which are not of this fold, Jesus said, them also I must bring in, or must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Now, what exactly happened? If you think about it, at this particular time, he's talking to the lost house of Israel, the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And his main ministry was to the Jews. Later on, the Gentiles will be grafted in, as Romans 11 talks about there, and how that the Gentiles had a division between the Jews. You know, that was a wall, a barrier, as Paul would call it, a wall of partition that was between the two. And he would tear down that wall. And then we realize what that meant, that they would be one in Christ. And it took a few years, but it was exactly what happened. But from Acts chapter 2 to Acts chapter 10, when Cornelius' household was brought in, the first Gentile converts to the Lord, that's exactly what happened. That's the context of the one-fold, one shepherd. Again, that's all talking about the oneness that the church has. But this other sheep is not talking about denominations. Now, some have tried to read that, put that into the text, but it is simply not there. In John chapter 15, verse 5, when Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches, and he talks about bearing fruit, he's not talking about denominations there as well. Some have tried to say, well, there you have it. Jesus is the vine, and you have all the different branches of denominations. Well, if you look at that passage very closely, he's talking about individuals. We have to keep that in context, because the context is talking about people there, people that are cut off because of unfruitfulness. Now, he doesn't cut off whole-scale congregations. He will actually, in Revelations 2 and 3, actually refers to removing the candlestick in some regard. But he's talking about those who are individuals. And that's exactly what the church is composed of. It's not of local congregations. It's built up of people. The people are the word that the Bible says are the church of God, the church of Christ. John chapter 17, 20 to 23, Jesus prayed for unity, particularly in verse 21. He said that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you. That they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. That's exactly what we're to pray for as well, that we would all tear down these religious divisions and traditions and doctrines of men, things that have been around for centuries now that have divided us. You know, how we read about the church is the church is to be one. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 10 to 13, I want to take some time to read this particular passage, because one place here is really the greatest indictment against denominationalism. And I say this in all fairness, because I only want to be what the Bible says we need to be. And if there are not denominations in the Scripture, if they are condemned in the Scriptures, any kind of division, then we should look at it as something that's not what God wants for the church to be. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, the Bible says, Now I exhort you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree that there be, I want to look at the, have this also on the chart here. Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together, the same mind and the same judgment. He's talking about a oneness of speaking the same thing. You know, if I go to one church down the road and they're saying something completely different, then they say, well, there's one God in the Trinity, or the actually refers to the Godhead there. And there's also three in the Godhead in another place. Well, that's a different thing. Or some might say baptism saves, and also some, well, baptism has nothing to do with your salvation. Then we're not speaking the same thing, are we? So there'll be no divisions among us. Be perfectly joined again in the same mind, the same judgment. He goes on to say in verse 11, For I have been informed concerning you, my brethren, by Chloe's people, Chloe's household, that there are quarrels among you. Now, I mean this, that each one of you is saying, I am of Paul, and I am of Apollos, and I of Cephas, and I of Christ. Now, we need to closely examine that particular verse, because that illustrates why denominationalism is wrong. It's because we cannot be of anyone but Christ. We cannot be Lutherans or Presbyterians or any other type of denomination that you can name. You can name a whole list of those. And every time you might say, well, what about this? Can I be of this? Many times people will hyphenate themselves as, well, I'm a a Baptist Christian. I'm a Pentecostal Christian. Well, they're simply only Christians that the Bible speaks of in the New Testament. So we have to learn to not do things. You know, this is the beginning of sectarianism, where people say, well, I'm a Paul. I'm a Paulite, in other words. Or I am of Cephas. I'm a Cephas. I'm a follower of Cephas. You know, we don't have any right to draw disciples away to ourselves. That's actually condemned in the scriptures. You can look at Romans chapter 16 and other places how some would do that very thing. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 and 5 says this: there is one body, one spirit, just as you're called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. There's a unity there that must not be missed, that we cannot have different faiths, different kinds of different ways of doing things. And simply follow the Bible without addition and subtraction, we can find what we need to find about the church. Then how do you read about baptism is also important. In Mark chapter 16, verses 15 and 16, here the Bible tells us there, he who has believed and is baptized shall be saved, but he who has disbelieved shall be condemned. That's very important because that scripture teaches us about salvation. Jesus himself said that, connects baptism with belief in regard to our salvation. Now, some read the Bible in that passage and say, well, baptism doesn't save, Christ saves. And I agree, Christ saves. Well, how does he save us? You know, is it just universal salvation, that everybody's saved, don't have to do anything, just believe? You know, there's more to it. Simply saving faith is more than simply mental assent in that Jesus is the Son of God. 1 Peter 3, 20, 21, the light figure whereunto baptism doth now also save us. You know, just like Noah and his household was saved, we have to realize baptism does save. That's why Peter commanded that Cornelius' household be baptized. Acts 22, verse 16, the Bible was told there, actually the Word of God says that Ananias told Saul of Tarsus, and now why are you delaying? Arise and be baptized, wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. So baptism does have something to do with our salvation. It's the obedience. And we realize faith ends in obedience. It culminates, and it actually goes hand in hand. Faith with our obedience is how we're saved. Now, some read baptism as an outward sign of an inward grace. Well, I have asked several people to show where that is in the scriptures and really haven't had a good response. And where does the Bible teach that? Some try to use Colossians 2, 10 to 14, comparing baptism to circumcision. Now, under the old law, it was that a person was born an Israelite, and then they were circumcised as a sign of the fact that they were a part of the tribe of Israel. And that was actually commanded. If they were not circumcised after 8 days, they cut off from the community of the Israelites. But in some regard, the new covenant is different than the old. As we realize, we are taught then born. Back in the Old Testament, they were born then taught. That to fear God and to be an Israelite, all the ways of God, it's actually differently now. The only circumcised, Colossians 2, verse 10 to 14, referring to baptism as cutting off the dead works of the flesh, the things that we are really trying to get rid of as far as our the things that we've done in the past and having a good conscience in that way. You know, verse 21 in 1 Peter 3 says, it's the answer of God of a good conscience. It's actually an appeal to God, the New American Standard has, for a good conscience. Well, how do you have a good conscience? It's when your sins are forgiven. You start by faith, repentance of your sins, confession of Jesus Christ, and baptism to make one free from your sins. Now, some read baptism because the remission of sins, because you already have the forgiveness of sins. In Acts chapter 2, verse 37, 38, on the day of Pentecost, the Bible tells us, then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. I want to say that it is bad exegesis to say this word is because the remission of sins. Do they repent because they've already been forgiven? Do they repent and be baptized? Now, this word for there is the Greek word ace. And this word actually refers going in the direction of something. It's always pointing forward in direction. And it's in order to, in other words. The Greek word gar is the one because. And so this is not because you already have the remission of sins. These people didn't know that if that was the case. And really the context, verse 40 and 41 bears this out by saying, and with many of the words he testified and exhorted them, saying, now why did Peter do that? Because he wanted them to be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls were added to them. That fits the context that baptism is for the remission of sins because you want to be saved and need salvation. Not that you already have it and you're doing it just as an outward sign of an inward grace that you already have this in this way. But in Acts 22:16, we refer to this as well, that's the reason why Saul of Tarsus was baptized, because he needed the forgiveness of sins. Now, how do you read about grace? Titus chapter 2, 11 and 12 tells us, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires, to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age. And so what is that saying to you and I? Grace teaches us. Grace has something to do with helping us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust in this particular passage. Some read that salvation is solely by God's grace, and they take Acts 15, verse 11, that we believe that we are saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus in the same way as they also are. Now, that's talking about the Gentiles and the Jews being saved the same way. Well, if you look back to Acts chapter 2, they were baptized on the day of Pentecost. They also were baptized when Cornelius' household was commanded in Acts 10, verse 48, to be baptized. So they were saved the same way. They were saved by grace, but it's not grace alone. I want to qualify that by saying, I believe salvation is by grace. It takes place in the mind of God. And if we're going to be saved, it's only because that grace was extended to us and we simply received it by the conditions of grace. And there are conditions of grace. This idea that Martin Luther had, sola gratia, by grace alone, if you take that as only, grace only, then everybody on the planet Earth will be saved without having to do one thing, because it's all by grace. It all takes place in the mind of God. But God puts conditions. We have to come to God based upon the conditions of faith and repentance and confession and baptism in order to receive that grace. Romans 6:23 tells us the free gift of God. It's free gift, but there are conditions in receiving that gift. Some might read it's all of God and none of me. Titus chapter 3, 4 through 7 is often cited for that particular reason. And some might say, well, it's all by grace, not of works, lest anyone should boast. That's what Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 actually says. We realize it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, things that we earn salvation because we're so good. We're like that Pharisee and the publican. The Pharisee says, I fast twice a week. I do all these things because I'm such a good person. So we have to do all that to earn salvation. I deny we can ever earn salvation. Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 5. The Ephesians, they did not earn salvation. They were told to be baptized because they'd only had obeyed the John's baptism. You know what thing about a gift is? Like in Joshua chapter 6, verse 2, passages we often go to show that God had given the city of Jericho to the Israelites. And so in verse 2, the Bible said, the Lord said to Joshua, see that I have given the town, given Jericho in your hand with its king and the valiant warriors. And he says in verse 3, you shall march around the city. Now, some might say, well, they don't have to do anything. God's already given it to them. No, they had to march around the city seven times. And the Bible tells us that last day, seven times, once per day, and the seven times the last day, I should say. And so it was a gift. Verse 16 tells us, at the seventh time when the priest blew the trumpets, Joshua said to the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. That tells us again about grace. It's not grace alone, but it's simply doing what God has commanded. I want to stop right there in our lesson. I had some more to say, but for now, that will be exactly what we need to hear today. And so if you're outside the body of Christ, maybe you need to come this grace, believing in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and obeying, accepting Him. That's based upon what the Word of God says. Don't put anything to the text that's not there, but simply do what the Bible says. And if somebody says something contrary to what you know the Bible teaches, don't accept something that's not true, it's fake. Until next time, have a good day, and God bless.